worship, a day of encouragement, a day of fellowship, a day of Bible study. I hope that today has been encouraging and edifying to you as we think about going out this week and living our lives for our Lord Jesus. Tonight we're going to spend a few moments in the text that Rick read for us just a few moments ago, Ephesians, the second chapter. So if you have your Bibles, I'd love for you to turn there with me. Ephesians chapter 2. We're going to spend some time this evening looking at verses 1 through 10. Ephesians chapter 2, if you'll join me there in verses 1 through 10, that's where we're going to pick up in just a moment. Think for just a moment about how powerful words can be. I read a story on the internet about a man who was walking down the sidewalk in a large city one afternoon. As he was walking down the sidewalk, he came up on a crumpled up piece of paper. Generally, he would have just passed it by. Generally, he wouldn't have even paid it any attention. But on this specific occasion, as he looked at that wadded up piece of paper, he saw that there was some writing on it, and that piqued his curiosity. And so he picked up the piece of paper, he unwadded it, he flattened it, and he found that on the piece of paper were four words: acceptance, forgiveness, tolerance, and gratitude. As he was writing about this situation that took place in his life, he said that was a moment that changed his life forever. He felt like that piece of paper was meant for him, that it was placed there for him. When he picked it up and read it, it was like a light bulb came on over his head. It was like something finally clicked in his brain. After reading those four words, he rethought how he lived his life, how he thought about other people, how he interacted with other people. Words are powerful. Words have the power to change us. Words have the power to transform us. When we come to this passage in Ephesians chapter 2, verses 1 through 10, there are two, not four, there are two words that have the power to change our lives forever. For those of us who are Christians, for those of us who are followers of Jesus, these two words in Ephesians 2, verses 1 through 10, have changed us not just in this life, but also in the life that is coming. These two words not only change our lives, but they are two words that give us life. They're the two words up on the screen in front of you. They're the first two words of Ephesians chapter 2 and verse number 4, but God. Those two words are so powerful. Those two words make all the difference in our lives when it comes to our spiritual standing before God, when it comes to our relationships with God. The way that we're going to talk about it tonight, we're going to talk about two categories. We're going to talk about who we were. We're going to talk about who we used to be. And then we're going to talk about who we are now in Jesus. And what we're going to see is that those two words, but God, is the difference maker. That's where the change comes. That's where the transformation happens. The difference between who I used to be and who I am now as a follower of Jesus all goes back to what God has done for me, what God has done in my life. So let's start in Ephesians 2 verses 1 through 3 by talking about who we were, talking about who we used to be. This is something that is true for every single one of us. I can't look down on you. You can't look down on me. I can't label you as a worse sinner, and you can't label me as a worse sinner. Because as we walk through Ephesians 2, verses 1 through 3, at some point in our lives, this is where we were. This is who we were. The first thing that Paul says in this passage is that at some point, we were dead in our trespasses and sins. You see that in verse 1? He says, and you were, past tense, dead. What does it mean to be dead? In its most basic form, in its most basic definition, death is a separation, isn't it? You look at the end of James chapter 2, and James is going to tell you that when the body is separated from the spirit, the end result is going to be physical death. We die physically when our spirits are separated from our physical bodies. Well, what kind of death is Paul talking about here in Ephesians chapter 2 and verse number 1? He's not talking about physical death. He's talking about spiritual death. What does it take to be spiritually dead? In order to be spiritually dead, here's the only thing that has to happen. You're separated from God. You're separated from your Creator. When you stand separated from the only one who can give you life, the end result is going to be spiritual death. Well, what causes us to be separated from God? What causes spiritual death to enter into our lives? Well, you keep reading. He says, you were dead in the trespasses and the sins in which you once walked, or the trespasses and sins in which you once lived. The word trespass there means to deviate from the right path. If I trespass on your property, if I trespass by going into your house without permission, I'm deviating from the path that I'm supposed to be on. The word sin literally refers to missing the mark. Have you heard that before? It's like shooting a bow and arrow at a target. If you shoot too high, too far to the left, too far to the right, too high, you're going to miss the target that's set up. Paul says, in a spiritual perspective, that is what has caused us to be dead. That's what caused us at one point to be separated from our Creator. It's our trespasses. Those times where we left, where we deviated from the path that God wanted us to be on. Those times when we committed sin, when we missed the mark that God had set up for us in what we said or what we thought or the way that we acted, the decisions that we made. In Isaiah 59 verses 1 and 2, the Bible reminds us that it is our iniquities that make a separation between us and God. That's where we used to be. That's who we used to be. We were dead in the trespasses and sins that we were walking in, the trespasses and sins that we were choosing to live in. Notice the second idea. Paul says at one point we were following the world in verse number 2. You skip just a few chapters to go to Ephesians 4, verses 17 through 19, and Paul describes for us what the world looks like. He says, you must no longer walk. You must no longer live as the Gentiles do in 17. In other words, don't live like the rest of the world. As a Christian, you have to be different. You can't be like everybody else. But then he goes on to describe what the world looks like. At the end of 17, they walk, they live in the futility of their minds. They're darkened in their understanding, alienated from the life of God because of the ignorance that's in them due to their hardness of heart. They have become callous, having given themselves up to sensuality, greedy to practice every kind of impurity. That's the way the world looked in Paul's time in the first century world. I would argue that's the way that the world looks today. But when you go to Ephesians chapter 2 and verse number 2, at one point, that's who we were. That's what our lives looked like. We were following after the course of the world. Then he continues on in verse 2. We weren't only following the world, we were also following after Satan. Satan is described in a couple of different ways when you look at verse number 2. First, he's described as the prince of the power of the air. In the first century Jewish mind especially, they thought of demons as living and dwelling in the air. You can't see the air. You also can't see demons who are dwelling in the air. So I believe Paul uses that terminology to tell us something about Satan. He's the prince of the power of the air. He's the one who is the ruler of the demonic force. He is the one who is the prince over the demonic world. But then he continues on to say that Satan is also the spirit that is now at work in the sons of disobedience. That Satan is the one working in individuals who are living disobediently to God. At one time, that's where we were. We were following after Satan. We were following after the prince of the power of the air, the one who controls all of the demons in existence, all of the evil angels. We were following after the one who was at work in the sons of disobedience. He was in work in us as we live disobediently to our Creator. You know, 1 Peter chapter 5 and verse number 8 says that the devil prowls around like a roaring lion, seeking someone to devour. According to Ephesians chapter 2 and verse 2, at one point Satan had completely devoured us. Number 4, at one point, we were living in the passions of our flesh. Paul reminds us in verse number 3. Notice the universal aspect of this. He says, among whom we all. Paul's talking about everybody there in the church at Ephesus. He's not exempting himself from this. He says, among whom we all once lived in the passions of our flesh, carrying out the desires of the body and the mind. The idea there is if my body wanted something, then I did it. If my mind desired something, then I gave myself over to that. We were living based on evil, sinful, lust, desires, and passions. And then he says, number five, that we were by nature children of wrath. Now, there are some who use that phrase in chapter 2 and verse number 3 who would come from a Calvinistic background who would suggest that that phrase teaches us that we are born into this world as sinners. We are born into this world inheriting the guilt and the sin of Adam. It's the idea of total depravity, that human beings are by nature children of wrath. I don't think that's what Paul is saying there. Because if you go back to Ephesians chapter 2 and verse number 1, we were dead in trespasses and sins, but it's not the trespasses and sins that we were born in with or born into. It was the trespasses and sins in which we what? In which we once walked or in which we once lived. We were spiritually dead, not because we inherited sin, but because we chose to live in sin. What do you call it when you do something consistently? You do it time and time and time again. Eventually, you're doing it by what? By nature. And I believe that's the message that's being presented to us in chapter 2 and verse 3, that at one time, we were consistently and continually practicing sin to the point that it became by nature, it became natural to us. And as a result, we were identified and labeled as children of wrath. People deserving the wrath of God, people living under the wrath of God, and if something didn't change, we would experience the holy wrath of God throughout all of eternity. And so you take a look at Ephesians chapter 2, verses 1 through 3. In order to appreciate where we are now, we have to understand where we once were. That at one point, we were dead in our trespasses and sins. We were following the world, following Satan, living in the passions of our flesh. We were by nature children of wrath. As we said, I can't say that you're a worse sinner than me. You can't say that I'm a worse sinner than you. Because we have a common background. We have a common heritage in Ephesians 2, verses 1 through 3. You know what's sad? When some Christians live their lives as if they're still there. When Christians live their lives feeling guilty about one time being there. As we continue reading throughout this passage, we're going to find some ideas that are so freeing, some ideas that are so liberating. But there's also the cold reality that perhaps there are some people in here tonight who are right there in Ephesians 2, verses 1 through 3. Because you've never made the decision to follow Jesus, to receive His grace by faith, as we're going to see in chapter 2 and verse number 8, you're right there in the midst of those five things, that list that we built over the last few minutes. The good news is that you don't have to stay there. You don't have to remain there. Because this text doesn't just tell us about who we were in the past. This text tells us about who we are now in Christ Jesus. The first thing that Paul tells us about who we are is that we're recipients of God's mercy. In chapter 2 and verse number 4, Paul gives us a statement about our God's character, that God is rich in mercy. When we think about our God, it's not just that He has a little bit of mercy, or He has enough mercy to get us by until the next day, or barely enough mercy to get us to eternity. It's the idea that our God is rich in mercy. Isn't that comforting to know? Isn't that empowering to know? What is mercy? The definition that we've oftentimes given to that word mercy is that God is withholding from us what we deserve. So like we said a few moments ago, we deserve God's wrath. We deserve an eternity separated from God in the fires of hell. We deserve His holy judgment and justice and wrath. But what does mercy do? Mercy steps in. God is rich in mercy. And it stops Him from giving us what we actually deserve, what we have merited for ourselves. Praise God for His mercy. Number two, we are not just recipients of God's mercy, but you keep reading in verse 4, we're recipients of God's love. Just like God's mercy is rich, how is His love described in verse number 4? The ESV says that it's great. Have you ever taken a second to pause and think about how great the love of our God actually is? Our God's love is great because it's an eternal love. Read through Psalm 136 sometime, and you're going to see the same phrase in every verse. There's 26 verses, so it appears 26 times. The steadfast love of God endures forever. Why is the love of our God so great? It's an eternal love. It's a love that has no end. It's a love that goes on forever. It's a love that's great because we can't be separated from it. Paul says in Romans 8, verses 38 to 39, that he's persuaded there's no external force, there's nothing in all of creation that can separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. It's a great love because it ultimately put Jesus Christ on the cross. That in Romans 5, God shows his love for us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. God, how much do you love me? I want to know how great your love actually is. Take a look at the cross of Jesus. Take a look at the blood that he was willing to shed. Take a look at the suffering that he was willing to go through. And that's how great the love of our God actually is. He shows us how much he loves us in that Christ died for us. Not good people, not righteous people, but sinners. Those who were dead in their trespasses and sins. We're recipients of God's mercy, recipients of God's love. And then you continue to chapter 2, verse 5, and Paul is going to focus his emphasis on Christ and our relationships with him. He says that we were made alive with Christ. Contrast that with chapter 2, verse 1. When we were dead in our trespasses and sins in which we once walked, but now we've been made alive with Jesus. At one point, we were separated from God as a result of our iniquities, our trespasses, and our sins. Now that separation has been closed. Now that separation doesn't exist. That great gulf has been crossed. And it's not based on anything that we've done. It's not based on how good we are. But it's all about what God has done. He has made us alive together with Jesus. But notice how this theme continues in chapter 2 and verse 6. That we're also raised up with Jesus. We talked about a couple of weeks ago in Ephesians 1 verses 19 and 20. How it is the great power of our God that raised Christ. The power that was worked in Christ when God raised him from the dead in chapter 1 and verse number 20. Jesus has been raised from the dead. At one time we were dead, and we have been raised up with him. We've been raised up alongside of Christ. You know, Romans chapter 6 tells us how to do that. When we're buried in the waters of baptism and raised up with him to walk in newness of life. Romans chapter 6 and verse number 4. But then the thing continues one more time in chapter 2 and verse 6. We're made alive with Christ. We're raised up with Christ. But then also in verse 6, we have been seated with Christ in the heavenly places. Now remember, the heavenly places in Ephesians refers to not this physical realm or physical dimension, but the spiritual realm, the spiritual dimension where God is. We've been seated with Jesus Christ in the heavenly realm, in the spiritual dimension. Now let me remind you about this place where Jesus Christ has been seated. We read half of verse 20 a moment ago that he worked in Christ when he raised him from the dead. But watch what happens next. Jesus is seated at God's right hand in the heavenly places. But what's so special about that location, being God's right hand? It's a place that's far above all rule, authority, power, and dominion, above every name that is named, not only in this age, but also in the age to come. Jesus Christ has sat down at the right hand of the throne of God in the heavenly places, in a position that's exalted, in a position where in the next verse, if we were to continue reading, all things have been put under his feet. Everything is in subjection to Jesus. Guess what? We're sitting right there next to him. As Christians, we're already reigning with Jesus. We're already sitting alongside of Jesus in victory. Jesus is sitting right next to God. Jesus is sitting at God's right hand, and we, as members of his body, are sitting right next to him. Been made alive with Christ, raised up with Christ, and seated with Christ in the heavenly places. Then you look at chapter 2 and verse number 7. Paul says that where we are now, we are recipients of God's kindness. Notice the future aspect of what he's talking about in verse 7. So that in the coming ages, he might show the immeasurable riches of his grace in kindness toward us in Christ Jesus. Did you notice that word, kindness? There are so many who have a negative view of God. There are so many who view God as antagonistic or mean or vindictive. They think that God is out to get them. God is waiting for them to mess up. God is dangling them over the fires of hell, just waiting for them to drop in. That is not the God we see in Ephesians 2 and verse number 7. In Ephesians 2 and verse 7, we find a God of kindness. A God who cares about us. A God who is reaching out to us and continually blessing us, even though we are so unworthy. And then we find an idea that really dominates this passage in verses 4 through 10. That where we are now, we are saved by the grace of God. You're going to find that phrase two times in this passage. Verse number 5, it's by grace that we've been saved. And then Ephesians chapter 2 and verse number 8, for it's by grace that you have been saved through faith. Grace is the unmerited favor of God. The favor of God, the blessings of God that we don't deserve. That we have no way of earning, that we have no way of meriting for ourselves. But yet through Christ Jesus, he gives it to us anyway. Grace is favor bestowed when wrath is owed. We said just a moment ago, chapter 2 and verse 3, that we were by nature children of wrath. But now that wrath has been set aside in order for us to receive God's grace, in order for us to receive God's favor. Grace, we oftentimes talk about it as the other side of the coin from mercy. We said that mercy is God withholding from us what we deserve. Grace, on the flip side of that coin, is God giving to us what we don't deserve. God withholds from us what we do deserve, his wrath and eternity separated from him, and instead he gives to us blessings and gifts in Ephesians 2 and verse number 8 that we will never deserve and could never deserve. For it is by grace that you have been saved through faith. And Paul wants you to know, that's not of yourselves. It's the gift of God, verse 9, not as a result of works, so that no one may boast. Paul wants us to know in no uncertain terms that we cannot save ourselves. You cannot get yourself to heaven. It's not, hey, do this many good works and then God will finally accept you and God will reward you by giving you his grace. His grace is not something that is earned or merited by our good works. It is something that is given as a free gift. For by grace you have been saved through faith. We can't walk around boasting and bragging, looking down on other people because we've received God's gift of salvation. Well, why can't we? Because it's not ours. We didn't do anything to earn it. We didn't do anything to deserve it. We didn't do anything to merit it. We are saved by grace through faith. Now, notice in Ephesians 2 and verse number 8 that the Bible does not say that we're saved by grace through faith alone. You're never going to find that teaching in the Scriptures. In fact, the only time that you find the words faith and alone beside each other is in James chapter 2. You know what it says? That a man is not justified by faith alone. And so we're not talking about faith alone here, but we're talking about the entire faith response. A faith that says, I believe what God says. A faith that says, I trust what God says. And a faith that says, I am willing to obey what God says. That is the kind of faith that is a saving faith when we study through the New Testament Scriptures as a whole. Again, notice we're talking about the present aspect of this, that it is by grace you have been saved through faith, not as a result of works so that no one may boast. But again, notice the future aspect in verse number 7, that in the coming ages, isn't this going to be beautiful to experience? That in the coming ages, he's going to show the immeasurable riches of his grace and kindness toward us in Christ Jesus. We are saved by his grace. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. And then finally, number 8, where we are now, we are God's workmanship. In Ephesians chapter 2, in verse number 10. That's what Paul said. Now that we have been saved by his grace, now that we are recipients of his mercy and love, been made alive with Christ, raised up with Christ, seated with Christ, God has demonstrated his kindness towards us. Now look at the way that we live. Look at how that changes our daily lives in verse number 10. That we are God's workmanship. We are those who God is working through in the world. We have been created in Christ Jesus for the purpose of good works. We said just a moment ago that we are not saved by the good works that we do. Instead, our good works are in response to the salvation that we've received. This is a really important idea to grasp. Maybe we've struggled with this in the Lord's church at some points, and we've gotten this out of order. We are not saved because of our good works. We do good works because we have been saved. That's important for us to understand. That changes the way we live. Because God has saved me by his grace, because he's given me his unmerited favor, because God has given me this gift in Ephesians 2 and verse 8, the gift of salvation, now I'm living as his workmanship. Now I'm doing good things, not in order to be saved, but because I am already saved, created in Christ Jesus for good works, verse 10, which God prepared beforehand. God's laid out the path that he wants us to go to. We mentioned in our prayer that the straight and narrow path just a moment ago. God has laid out the course that he wants us to run on. And it's our responsibility to run on it. God has laid out those good works beforehand, and it's our responsibility to walk in them. To be so changed by his grace, to be so changed by his mercy, to be so changed by his love, what he has done in our lives, that we live every day doing good things, doing good works, reflecting the great glory of our God. And so in this passage, we see two different places where a person can exist. As Christians, as those of us who are followers of Jesus in here tonight, we have experienced both of these places. When you say one of them is a lot better. In Ephesians 2, verses 1 through 3, Paul finds it important to remind us who we were, who we used to be, that we were dead in our trespasses and sins. We were following the world, following Satan, living in the passions of our flesh. We were by nature children of wrath. But thanks be to God that we didn't have to stay there. He also wants to remind us who we are in chapter 2, verses 4 through 10. The blessings that we are able to claim, recipients of God's mercy and love. We've been made alive with, raised up with, seated with Christ. Recipients of God's kindness, saved by his grace. We are God's workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works. You look at who we were, verses 1 through 3. You look at who we are in verses 1 through 10. How did that change happen? How did that transformation take place? How did we go from where we were to where we are now? Remember how we started? It's two simple words right there at the beginning of verse number 4. But God. Really has nothing to do with us, does it? It doesn't have anything to do with how good we are, how faithful we are, how dedicated we are. This change and transformation in our lives has taken place all because of God. God is the difference maker. Paul talks verses 1 through 3, here's who we were, but God stepped into that situation. And as a result, here is where we are. Here is who we are now. Two words that make a difference in our lives on a daily basis. Two words that make a difference in our eternity. But God. Now, how do we respond to a message like that? Our response is dependent upon our relationships with God. Have you made the decision to become a Christian? If you have made the decision to become a Christian, this goes back to a conversation that we had many weeks ago in chapter 1 and verse number 3, where we are blessing God, we are praising God because of how much he has blessed us. When we think about what God has done in our lives, how could we not praise him? How could we not recognize how worthy he is of everything that we have? and everything that we are. How could we not live our lives in gratitude when we look at a text like this one and we recognize the transformation that we have experienced by His grace? It should motivate us to go out every day, to go out every day this week and be His workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works. If you are a Christian, I hope you'll recognize how blessed you are. I hope that your heart will be filled with a sense of gratitude. I hope your heart will be filled with a sense of thankfulness that will come out as praise, that will come out as good works, that will look to glorify our Father. If you've not made the decision to become a Christian, then that's where you need to start. Go back to chapter 2, verses 1 through 3. If you've never named Christ, then that's where you are. You're dead in your trespasses and sins. But as we've said a few times, you don't have to stay there. If you have questions about your salvation, if you have doubts about your salvation, you're standing before God, you don't have to walk out those doors tonight with that in your heart. Let's take care of it as together we stand.